is Wizzie Brown, and I'm with Texas A&M AgriLife Extension Service, and I am an entomologist that specializes in IPM. And IPM stands for Integrated Pest Management. So essentially there, we're trying to do a whole bunch of stuff to reduce or avoid pest problems before they really become a huge, huge problem. This year has been a very odd year for weather, and that has led to it being problematic for various insect pests. We've been dealing with stuff that we haven't seen before, or numbers that we haven't seen. And a lot of people have asked me earlier in the year if the freeze that we had is going to affect insect populations. And while many people are hoping that I'm going to say yes to that, unfortunately, the answer is going to be no, because insects have a lot of adaptations to survive freezing temperatures. So if you think of some place that's really cold, like Wisconsin or Alaska, those places still have insects. And that is because insects can dig down into the ground below the freeze line. They are capable of hiding in cracks and crevices under tree bark and leaf litter. They also have some really cool adaptations where they can push the water molecules out of their cells. And so when it freezes, it doesn't cause the cells to burst. And then when it's not freezing anymore, they'll actually kind of go back to normal. And then there are some insects that actually develop a chemical that is very similar to the antifreeze that we put in our vehicles. So all of these adaptations are going to help them survive the freezing temperatures. The other big topic that is hot in the insect world right now is the brood X cicadas. And I have been getting a lot of questions about those. We don't have brood X cicadas in Texas. So the brood X is called brood 10. And these are a group of cicada species. So I think there's anywhere from 3 to 7 that could be in the different brood numbers. And they emerge in large, large numbers. And essentially what they're doing is they are saturating the environment with so many cicadas that it's causing the predators that feed on those cicadas to be able to eat enough. And then there's still a whole bunch of cicadas left over that they can mate and lay eggs and still go through that life cycle. So that's actually called either predator saturation or prey saturation, depending on if you're looking at it from the cicada standpoint or whatever's eating it. The brood X cicadas that everyone is talking about are on the eastern seaboard as well as in the Midwestern states. This is a very large brood that is emerging. And these are 17-year cicadas. So it takes these cicadas 17 years to go from the egg to the adult stage. So they spend the majority of that time underground feeding on the roots of trees. And they spend only a few weeks emerged out as adults. Essentially, once they emerge as adults, their job is to find a mate, to mate, and then they lay eggs. And then after those females lay eggs, they actually will die. And they, you know, will either be eaten by something or they'll drop to the ground and they'll turn into compost. So while we don't have brood X, we do have our normal cicadas here in Texas. We have a whole bunch of different ones. We have annual cicadas. We have some that are on varying year life cycles, but they're just a sound of summer that we have here. And coming along with the cicadas that will start emerging soon are going to also be the cicada killer wasps. So this is what I personally call the wasp on steroids, because these are probably some of the largest wasps that we have in Texas. And they have a reddish brown head and a reddish brown thorax. And then their abdomen goes anywhere from a reddish brown to a black color. And that abdomen is going to have yellow markings on it. So a lot of people are concerned right now when they, or at least they were last year. And I'm sure they'll be concerned this year as well. But they are concerned when they see the cicada killer wasps, and they thinking that they are the Asian giant hornets. We do not have Asian giant hornets in Texas. They have been found in the United States, but it's only in Washington state currently. There's really no need to kill the cicada killer wasps. They are fairly docile. The females are going to be solitary. They go down into the ground, and that's where they're creating their nurseries for their babies. The males can be somewhat aggressive and territorial. So if you walk through their space, they will kind of go around and buzz around you. But if you just keep walking, then they're just going to leave you alone. But these are beneficial as predators. They're going to be feeding on the cicadas that are in the trees. So if you're somebody who finds the cicada noise annoying, then you might want to consider welcoming the cicada killer wasps into your yard. So another big event that we have been having in Texas this year is rain. And with rain, we have been having multiple issues, probably the next three that I'm going to be talking about. So the first one, it's two totally separate arthropods. So an arthropod's going to have an exoskeleton. Their bones are on the outside. But the arthropods that I'm talking about right now are going to be millipedes, which are going to be a type of myriapod. And then the other one are sow bugs, which are sometimes called roly-polies or pillbugs or sometimes potato bugs. And then sometimes people also call them doodlebugs, but for entomologists, we actually call doodlebugs antlion larvae. So this is why when we're doing things scientifically, we really need a genus species so we can keep track of what people are actually talking about. Because if you say doodlebug, it may mean a roly-poly to somebody. It could mean an antlion larvae to someone else. But the millipedes and the pillbugs are going to look very similar, but they are completely different. Sow bugs or roly-polies or pillbugs or whatever you want to call them, they're actually a land-dwelling crustacean. So they have gills and they need really, really, really moist environments. And usually you'll find them outside in leaf litter and things like that. Millipedes often in the same environment, but they don't have gills. So when they need a level of moisture for survival, with all the rain that we've been getting, it really gets to be too much moisture. And so that has led to millipedes or pill bugs moving indoors. And if you're finding them inside your house, which I have found a few in my house, it essentially means that you need to go around the outside of your house and look for where they're coming in and seal that particular area. And I've already found mine. I have not repaired it yet. But I need to replace the weather stripping around my front door because that's where they're coming in. If you can see light around your door when you are standing inside, then it needs to have the weather stripping replaced. Another thing that the rain has brought up are all of the fire ant mounds. A lot of times we think that the fire ants are gone, but unfortunately, that's not the case. Fire ants are probably here to stay. They are well encroached within the environment here in Texas. And the thing with the rain is that it drives those fire ants up out of that saturated soil. So again, there's too much moisture in the soil. And so they tend to build larger mound areas because they're trying to get the workers and the queens and the larvae and pupae and all that up out of the water saturated soil. So what does that mean for us? One, you'll see more fire ant mounds because they are more noticeable. They're building larger mounds. But two, since they're trying to get out of the water saturated soil, if there isn't a chance of rain within the next 24 hours, it's a great time to treat those individual mounds for fire ants because they're closer to the soil surface. And so you're going to be able to kill them more readily with those contact pesticides or, usually what I do, I tend not to treat individual fire ant mounds. When I am controlling fire ants, I do a broadcast bait over my whole entire yard. And I find that to be easier and it's more cost effective as well as it places less pesticide into the environment. So fire ant bait is going to be actually a food source for the fire ants, and it has the pesticide that kills them impregnated into that food source. And so when I broadcast that, the fire ants will seek that bait out as food. And that's why you don't want it to rain or you have that bait get wet for 24 hours, because it's kind of like eating a soggy cheeseburger. Nobody likes soggy cheeseburgers. They don't want soggy fire ant bait. So you want to keep the bait dry, allow them to do the work for you. They'll pick up that bait, carry it back to the mound, and then they are going to share that with the other ants that are in the mound, including the queen. And so it's a better opportunity to be able to kill that queen when you're using those fire ant baits. Now, you can use baits as well as individual mound treatments. So a good thing to do is to do a baiting in the spring and in the fall, and then hit individual mounds in between those two periods of time. The last thing that I'm going to talk about that has to do with the rain are mosquitoes. And I think everybody is well aware that the mosquitoes right now are absolutely crazy. And part of the reason why mosquitoes are such an issue right now is not only do we have our normal mosquitoes, and you know, by normal, I'm talking about the ones that we're used to having or used to seeing around our house. And those are usually the Culex mosquitoes or the Aedes mosquitoes. And those mosquitoes are typically going to be found in standing water that we have around our home. So when you hear that whole drain standing water or treat it with mosquito dunks, like the BTI products and things like that, those are the mosquitoes that we're talking about, because those mosquitoes will stay in the general area where they are coming out of when they are immature. So the water is going to hold the egg stage, the larval stage, and the pupal stage. So treating that standing water as a source is a lot easier than trying to manage the adult populations that are capable of flying around. So the big problem after we've been having all of this rain is that we're also dealing with other species of mosquitoes that are known as floodwater species. And these mosquitoes are different. They don't lay their eggs in standing water. They actually will lay their eggs in the soil. And when that soil gets flooded with water, hence the floodwater name, that is when those eggs hatch out and they go through their life cycle really quickly, because they know that that water source is going to dry up fairly rapidly. So these mosquitoes tend to be larger and they tend to be more noticeable when they bite you. I actually was talking to someone earlier about that today. So essentially for the floodwater species, they're a little bit more difficult to manage because you can't go around your yard and figure out where the standing water is. The floodwater species are capable of flying up to 5 miles to get a blood meal. So you could do everything that you want in your yard and it could be that they're still coming because, you know, it's way down the road that they're actually coming from. So I think the best thing that you can do to protect yourself against mosquitoes is choosing a proper mosquito repellent for when you are spending a significant amount of time outside. And there are websites that you can go to find this out. There is, of course, the CDC. They're going to recommend generally 5 active ingredients of mosquito repellents that will help protect you against the mosquitoes that are known for transferring or vectoring diseases. And those are DEET, picaridin, IR3535, oil of lemon eucalyptus, and 2-undecanone. Something else that is probably emerging right now and causing issues for people are the June beetles or June bugs. So these are fairly large, noticeable beetles, and they're not too problematic as adults in the sense that they really don't do much, at least the ones that we're getting now. We get some later in the summer that are called green June beetles or fig beetles, and those are pests on, obviously, figs, since they're called fig beetles, and they will actually chew the fruit and cause damage to that. But the June bugs, the brown ones that we're seeing right now, they are more of a nuisance than anything. They do fly and they don't seem to be very good at it sometimes because they crash into things. And they can be quite frightening for some people because they are fairly large. And if you aren't a fan of insects, then, you know, that might be annoying for you. Something that I actually recommended to somebody recently, that their daughter was terrified of June bugs and they were going camping. I told them to get a tennis racket and give it to the little girl, or a badminton racket, and she could whack the June bugs out of the way. And, you know, then they just kind of go someplace else and she doesn't have to worry about them. But June bugs can lead to turf problems. So June bugs are going to have an immature stage called a white grub, and those are going to feed on the roots of turf grass. And depending upon the health of your lawn and other stressors that you might have going on in your turf, then grubs may cause damage. So when they do cause enough damage, or they're in high enough levels of causing damage, they are going to cause kind of brown patchiness in your turf. And sometimes you may be clued in that you have a grub problem because you have a lot of birds that are pecking around in your yard, like grackles, or you may have armadillos that are frequenting your lawn, digging around in things. And usually those are signs that you might have grubs. So you would need to cut soil sections. Just take a knife or some other sharp implement and cut out a 4x4 inch soil section and look in the root zone. You want to do that in multiple places, and you're going to look for the grubs themselves. And so then if you see those grubs, you can treat them if you need to. But if they're, a lot of times you'll have grubs in your garden. I find them all the time when I'm gardening. And not all species of grubs are going to cause damage on your turf or your plants. And so a lot of times when I find white grubs in my lawn when I'm doing stuff, I'll throw them in my tray bird feeder and I'll let the birds eat them. And, you know, it's an easy, quick fix. I don't have to worry about spraying pesticides or anything like that. Something else that I think always comes hand in hand with the summer season, which is coming up soon, are fireflies. And they kind of, it's that quintessential insect of summer. Well, you know, I kind of think cicadas, but when I was a kid, it was fireflies because there were a lot more fireflies where I grew up and when I grew up. So fireflies are a beetle, and they actually have a way of bioluminescing, which essentially means that they glow. And they will glow in the larval form. So they have an immature or a larva-like stage that is in the soil. And those larvae are actually really beneficial to have. They're predaceous. And not only predaceous on other insects, but also predaceous on snails. So if you have a good snail population in your yard, you definitely want to encourage fireflies to be in there. But the adults are really fun to watch. A lot of them are going to be able to flash those colors. It's usually like a yellowy green. Some of them are more blue or orange. And that's an easy way to see that something is a firefly, but not all fireflies actually flash. Some of them do not do that. So if you want to encourage fireflies, the larvae typically are in more moist organic areas. So it may be that we have a decent crop of fireflies this year since we've had a lot of rain, and that can work in with the organic matter that we have. So you can encourage them by keeping leaf litter on the ground, making sure that you're composting things. If you rake up that leaf litter, a lot of times you may be raking up any larvae that are in it, because the fireflies are going to spend the majority of their lifetime in that immature larval stage. So right now we have, I just saw my first firefly actually last week. And so when the adults come out and they mate, they'll lay their eggs in the soil, those eggs hatch, and then it spends that larval stage all through summer, through fall, through winter, and then they emerge out again as larvae in the following spring, or sometimes it takes 2 years. And then those larvae will eventually pupate that spring, and then they emerge out as adults, kind of late spring, early summer. So the other thing about fireflies that we have to be concerned about is light pollution. And essentially, I think everybody knows what light pollution is at this point, but it's very difficult for the fireflies to find mates if they are one of those species that flashes to be able to find and locate where the males and females are respectively. So if we have a bunch of light in the area, you leave your porch light on and things like that, that can affect them from finding other fireflies for mating purposes. So if you want to encourage fireflies, keep your leaf litter on the ground, turn off your porch light at night. I do a series of webinars generally on every other Friday. And if you're interested in future webinars, then you can email me and get on my email list and I will send that information out. And then the other fun thing that I have been introduced this year is we are doing podcasts and we have two of them. One of them deals with structural pests, which may or may not interest you. And that one is called Unwanted Guests, but we do have one that is about insects in the landscape, which is a lot of fun. That one is called Bugs by the Yard. And you can find those on whatever streaming platform you prefer for podcasts. So again, I'm Wizzie Brown with Texas A&M AgriLife Extension Service, and have a great day.